Fall Fest took place last weekend. Guests had a chance to witness the crowning of the new Mr. and Miss A&M San Antonio. Local officials had some good laughs for a great cause at a fundraiser that took place at A&M San Antonio last Saturday.
We have heavy rainfall and a cold front coming in tonight. Stay tuned for more.
And welcome to this week's edition of Enlace. I am Gabriela Medina, and today we will cover the latest stories happening on campus and around San Antonio. A&M San Antonio continued a beloved tradition of family fun during their annual Fall Fest. David Rojas has more.
Cada otoño, la Universidad de Texas A&M San Antonio vive el cambio de estación de una manera muy festiva. Fall Fest, o el Festival de Otoño, es una fiesta anual que se celebra para reunir a familias de la comunidad en San Antonio. Con música en vivo, comida y juegos para los niños, la universidad recibió a la comunidad de sus alrededores.
Because there's so many things to do and the community from the Southside and Texas A&M really connect with the games and all the food that's available here, so that's always awesome.
Este evento es organizado por un grupo de estudiantes que se esfuerza cada año en planear para que este festival sea todo un éxito.
It was a lot of step by step coming, a lot of people coming together, finding different organizations, and basically everyone coming together and seeing like the whole big picture.
Durante el festejo, se aprovechó el momento para poder presentar a los nuevos Mr. y Miss A&M San Antonio. Zach y Alisa serán los nuevos estudiantes que representarán a la universidad.
I'm feeling ecstatic. Just to be able to represent the campus is just an amazing opportunity, and to be able to, again, have all of the students represent, be represented by me off campus when I'm with the president is ecstatic.
I'm pretty excited. My family's here, all my friends supported me. I give thanks to all my friends because I'm not close to home anymore, so it's amazing.
Los asistentes pudieron comprar artesanías locales, interactuar con animales y tomarse fotos.
Porque es un ambiente familiar, es algo para toda la familia y sobre todo para nuestros hijos que se pueden superar y seguir adelante.
Un ambiente sano.
Con este y más eventos, la universidad se prepara para clausurar la celebración de su décimo aniversario. El próximo evento será el 3 de diciembre cuando el campus se ilumina para el festejo conocido como Luces de Esperanza. Para Enlace, David Rojas.
10 A&M San Antonio alumni were recognized at the university's second annual alumni ceremony brunch. Arisela Mendez tells us more.
Texas A&M San Antonio hosted their second alumni ceremony. The Alumni Affairs Office awarded 10 alumni from the classes of 2009 through 2018 in honor of the university's 10th anniversary. Friends, family, and fellow alumni joined to recognize 10 individuals who have made a positive impact in and out of their community.
Since graduating, I've actually gone on to open my own company and also recently named as the CEO and president of the San Antonio Area Tourism Council.
A small selection committee included the director of alumni engagement, Dr. Mary Kay Cooper, a current professor, a past award recipient, and the president of SGA.
So I sat with them and we went through all the nominations. Probably had 46, 52, so a goodly number of nominations, and we went through those and made a determination about who we wanted to represent each class this year.
The recipients received one of three nominations.
One is the Distinguished Alumni Award, and that's to celebrate really great, stellar service in their professional life. And then we have the Recent Graduate Award, and that's someone who's graduated with their undergraduate degree in the last 3 years, and they're doing really neat things out in the world. And then last is the Spirit of the Jaguar Award. That's really oriented on service, so it could be volunteerism, but service to the community, and that can be the university community, San Antonio, or the larger world.
Each alumnus and alumna received a crystal obelisk and a framed citation for their accomplishments.
I'm humbled by being awarded that, because it says that I must be doing something noteworthy. I must be doing something that the A&M San Antonio community thinks is commendable.
For Enlace, this is Arisela Mendez.
Here at the Univision Media Lab, we want to be social with you. Like and follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at Univision Media Lab. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and comment on your favorite shows. The Society of Professional Journalists hosted their 7th annual Gridiron Fundraiser on campus. Local officials were invited to sit back, relax, and enjoy a good laugh for a good cause. Here's Oziel Trevino with more.
Every year, local media professionals have an opportunity to dance, sing, and play different characters that gives them a way to express themselves outside of their daily work routine, and all for a good cause.
It is a satire show, but I've seen it grow into having an opportunity to have some pieces where we discuss some real serious issues.
I understand how much it means to young college students and their parents to have that support through the scholarships to help pay for their tuition.
So we all kind of just put our talents together and see who can do what, and it's great to see the final product.
On October 12th, the Society of Professional Journalists of San Antonio's Pro Chapter joined the local media's professionals at Texas A&M University's San Antonio's auditorium to produce a show that raises money for future student journalists. We spoke to a student journalist who expressed his thoughts about the first time volunteering with prop building, painting, and acting.
Yes, this is my first time doing Gridiron here. Been a student here for 5 semesters, and first time I'm participating. I love it. It's fun.
This year's skits featured a variety of many local, state, and national politicians. Presidential candidate Julian Castro spared some time with his campaign to perform a skit at Gridiron.
But I've always had a very strong appreciation for the work of journalists, and especially now supporting local journalism is so important, and so I wanted to, you know, pitch in how I could.
Three media professionals share their thoughts about the show Gridiron.
I'm really excited because this is the one time of the year that I get together with this family, the Gridiron family.
I'm probably going to be involved in Gridiron for as long as it isn't happening and probably the rest of my life.
It's just an interesting Gridiron this year.
And that was an insight of what Gridiron is all about. Our professional journalists in San Antonio coming together to raise money for college students all over San Antonio. For Enlace, Ocia Treviño.
The south side of San Antonio is having an issue with some of its four-legged citizens, or is it city side? We will have more of this after the break.
The cold front is going to bring heavy winds and heavy rain tonight. More after the break.
One in three adults has prediabetes. One in three. That means it could be you, your favorite brother, your other brother. You,
yes.
Your football buddy, your football buddy. You, the boss, the boss's boss. If one in three adults has prediabetes, that means it could be you, your barber, your barber's barber.
Nice work.
Thanks. Thanks.
You, your plumber.
Breathe right into your foot.
Your plumber's masseuse.
Yes.
You, your dog walker.
On your left.
Your cat jogger. Or you, your co-pilot. Your co-pilot's co-pilot. While one in three adults has prediabetes, with early diagnosis, prediabetes can be reversed. Take the risk test at doihaveprediabetes.org to know where you stand.
Welcome back. A funeral mass at San Fernando Cathedral celebrated the legacy Emilio Nicolás Sr. left behind on Monday afternoon. Archbishop Gustavo Garcia Sierre presided over the mass. The sounds of mariachis filled the air as loved ones bid their final farewells and paid their respects to the media pioneer. People present at the service and longtime co-workers described Nicolás as a trailblazer, giving a voice to the Spanish language media in the Alamo City and nation. Nicolás was also active in his community, rallying for civic causes and serving on numerous boards. Nicolás passed away on October 12th in his San Antonio home. He was 88 years old. According to the City of San Antonio Animal Care Services, the south side of San Antonio has a major problem with stray dogs. Daniel Gallegos went out to investigate whether it's more of a citywide issue.
If you are a San Antonio resident, you might have heard that the south side of San Antonio has a problem with stray dogs. According to the City of San Antonio Animal Care Services, approximately 30,000 dogs are taken into their facility every year. And that is just one of the shelters out of the many that are located within the city. In relation to these stats being so high, the question comes up, is the south side really the only part of the city that is contributing to this issue? Instead of going to where the problem seems to be, I went to the opposite side of the city and spoke to the executive director of Elotes Humane Society, the nonprofit shelter that is located in the northwest side of San Antonio, and I questioned her on what she thinks of the situation.
People just not keeping their animals properly confined. They get out of the yard, they run the streets, get hit by cars. So I don't think it's necessarily one part of town. I think it's widespread.
Since San Antonio as a whole appears to be contributing to this issue, what really is the cause for the overpopulation of stray dogs? David Adams, a kennel tech employed at Paws Ranch Rescue, had just the answer.
Spaying, neutering their pets, you know, that keeps them from overpopulating really fast. You know, if you have an area, let's say you start off with four stray dogs, then by the end of the year, you might have 10, 15 stray dogs. And it keeps snowballing after that.
San Antonio residents might be at a loss in how they personally can reduce the number of strays or even how they can contribute to reducing the dogs in shelters. The answer is quite simpler than you think.
So as a San Antonio community, what we can do is, first of all, make sure that we're always monitoring our pets. Many San Antonio pet owners don't pay attention to their pets, they don't pay attention to their fences, and that makes the animal want to escape, leave.
Stray dogs will continue to be an ongoing issue unless San Antonio comes together to resolve this problem. Whether it's providing a safe environment for your dogs or even going to a local nonprofit shelter and picking up a new best friend. The important thing is that we come together to help these animals get off the streets and out of the shelters. For Enlace, Daniel Gallegos.
Hello, thank you for staying with us today. My name is Arisela Mendez, and let's go ahead and jump into the weather. Starting off with our humidity levels here in San Antonio, we're at an almost high 58%. This is due to the on and off showers we've been experiencing here in the city. Moving on to our coast of Texas forecast. So Padre Island and Corpus Christi are not gonna see the heat until about Saturday. When we look over here at Galveston, the temperatures will remain the same the whole weekend. Moving on to our current temperatures here in San Antonio, we are at a high 82 degrees. The cold front is seen over here in the hill country, and it's going to be move towards the west. So over here in Gonzales, as it's an 84 degrees, that's because it hasn't seen the cold front yet. But once it does reach, the temperatures will start to drop later on tonight. As we go into our extended forecast, the weekend calls for about 70 degree weather, which is really nice as we do have an upcoming festival here in San Antonio, which is Mala Luna. As we look at Monday, that's going to be our hottest temperature of the week with a high of 81 degrees. And then we go into Tuesday and Wednesday, we do have a 30% chance of rain both days, but then it does clear up with sunny but still cloudy skies on Thursday, which is perfect weather for Halloween, and it's good it's clearing up.
It looks like I'm gonna have to rent some movies and stay in tonight, huh?
Yes, and if you do have Halloween decorations, please be sure to secure them as wind will reach up to 40 miles per hour tonight.
All right, thank you, Arisela. And when we come back, Mr. and Miss A&M San Antonio, Zach and Alyssa are backstage to give us some insight on what it really feels like to be royalty.
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she didn't know what to do.
Did you have a good day at school?
She gave them some broth. Without any bread. Kiss them all soundly.
Thank you.
Night night.
Good night.
And put them to bed. Hunger is a story we can end. End it at feedingamerica.org.
Welcome back. Are you registered to vote? This November, Texans get to vote on 10 propositions to amend the state constitution. These are 10 different proposals. Proposition 1. Currently, the state constitution does not allow individuals to occupy more than one public office at one time. Proposition 1 would open the door for individuals to act as municipal judges for more than one municipality at the same time. Proposition 2 would allow the Texas Water Development Board to issue bonds to provide assistance for the development of projects on economically distressed areas. Proposition 3 would allow the Texas legislature to create temporary property tax exemptions to property damaged by disaster areas. Proposition 4 would ban the Texas legislature from imposing an individual income tax. Proposition 5 would designate the sporting goods sales tax towards funding state parks and historic commission. Proposition 6 would allow the legislature to increase the maximum amount of bonds it can raise for the Cancer Prevention and Research Institute of Texas. Proposition 7 would open the door for General Land Office and other units in the state government to double the amount of revenue they can provide to Texas schools. Proposition 8 would create a flood infrastructure fund to be managed by the Texas Water Development Board. Proposition 9 would allow the legislature to create property tax exemptions for materials stored in precious metal depositories. And Proposition 10 would create an opening for the adoption of retired law enforcement animals by qualified handlers or caregivers. There you go. To read more about these propositions, find out more about your polling place and visit VoteTexas.gov. So we're sitting here with Zach and Alyssa, which is the new Mr. and Miss A&M San Antonio. Thank you and welcome. Yep. So let's get into things. Zach, tell me, what was the campaigning process like?
Yeah, the campaigning process was good. Initially, the individual that I was running with unfortunately didn't make it to the interview. So who I expected to be with or to run with actually didn't make it, which provided like some challenge and for me to overcome.
Yeah, I bet that was, it brought some anxiety,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, a little bit. And I didn't even know if I would have a shot to make it just because I was so unprepared, right? And I didn't really know what it would take for me or what the process would expect. But I had a lot of people who were by my side who backed me and who helped me in the tabling process to just garner the attention necessary to get those votes. So yeah, I'm very, very thankful and it was a good process.
Yeah, so support was key, I hear.
Very much so, yeah.
Awesome. And Alyssa, tell me, were there any hardships that you had to overcome during this process?
Yes, so I had allergies in the first week of campaigning, and then I went to the doctor that weekend and then he said, you have an upper respiratory infection.
Oh, no.
So it was very hard to talk to people and to have like that loud voice that mm-hmm. people want to hear. But I just went through it. I took, of course, all my medication, and it was still kind of hoarsey when they announced Mr. and Mrs. A&M, and then talking to a bunch of people after that. It was a challenge just to talk to a bunch mm-hmm. of people and my throat hurting all the time.
So how do you think you were able to get your word out?
A lot of supporters, like what Zach said. I had a lot of friends who were just very supportive of me of doing it. And then, of course, I work for the University Police Department as a student worker. And I talked to a lot more students around that area and across campus with that role.
Oh, that's awesome. So y'all tell me, what was it like when you heard your name announced on stage?
It was super exciting. I'll be honest, because I'm president of Delta Chi, the other men that were running were actually in Delta Chi. So I expected to lose just because I wanted to be able to quickly support them and to back them if they won, right? Because that's what's necessary as a leader. So yeah, I didn't really expect to win because it was just necessary for me to succeed in my other role.
Well, like I said, I had two of like sides where I was in uniform and wasn't in uniform, and a lot of people didn't recognize me mm-hmm. without uniform. So that was a big challenge. And I just was very shocked when I heard my name, but I'm glad that it happened.
Well, thank you so much for coming and visiting. Yeah. And next we have Alejandro Diaz with sports.
Buenas, buenas. Los saluda Alejandro Díaz y bienvenidos a Jaguar Sports, con lo mejor del deporte en esta semana. Empezamos en Europa con acción de la Liga de Campeones de la UEFA, el torneo más importante de clubes en el mundo, que esta semana vivió otra jornada. Y para finalizar, como habíamos anticipado en nuestro anterior programa, las Jaguarettes, el equipo de baile de Texas A&M San Antonio, se presentó en la antesala al último partido de pretemporada de los San Antonio Spurs. Las chicas se presentaron con una coreografía de la Universal Dance Association, Ezra Land, Brooke Finch y Jerry Lee Rios. Según su entrenadora, Courtney Bob Meilinger, el objetivo ahora es presentarse en el medio tiempo de un partido de la próxima temporada. Bueno, esto ha sido todo por hoy, pero nos vemos la próxima semana con más de Jaguar Sports.
So the Jaguarettes, it's amazing that they had an opportunity like that.
Yeah.
And they had to fundraise, correct?
Yes, so they were raising some funds. They were selling their tickets. They had a link in their Instagram page. They were selling the tickets, so hopefully to raise some funds for that game and for their goal in the future. They didn't quite meet that goal, but you know they still have the goal of performing, hopefully, at the halftime of one of the games next season. So we'll see.
Oh, well, that's awesome. Thank you, Alejandro. Feeling a little stressed lately? Daniel Gallegos gives us some tips on how you can boost your happiness levels.
No one said signing up for college meant signing up for stress. According to a National College Health Assessment, only 1.6% of undergraduates reported being stress-free in the last 12 months. But don't be frightened just yet. There's a way to reduce such stress. The answer, a good exercise routine. According to an article published by Mayo Clinic, physical activity helps bump up your endorphins, which are chemicals that relieve stress and boost your happiness levels. Exercise also improves your mood. A good routine can increase self-confidence and refine your sleep, which is usually disrupted by stress. However, stress is inevitable. You can't escape it, especially when you're a student getting engulfed with assignments left and right. Always remember to consult with your doctor if you have any health concerns before going out and exercising. An active lifestyle can give you that control of life that you lose to stress. For Enlace, Daniel Gallegos.
Have you seen the new art sculptures behind CAB? When we come back, Armando Villarreal tells us about the opening of a citywide exhibit.
Leaving hot coals improperly extinguished can cause a wildfire.
Hey guys, it's Smokey!
It looks as if Smokey is going to use the drown, stir, drown, and feel technique. After the first drown, a good stir. Next, another drink. And finally, a close feel.
Is it cool?
Okay. Yeah.
Hey Smokey, catch! Oh, my bad Smokey.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Have you seen the art behind CAB? Armando Villarreal gives us more.
Las matemáticas y la geometría son la fórmula para crear esculturas, arquitectura, diseño de moda y muebles. El arte de este tipo es parte del paisaje de en toda la ciudad de San Antonio, como en el caso de la Antorcha de la Amistad en el centro. El artista mexicano Sebastián, creador de esta escultura, visitó San Antonio para presentar una nueva exposición. La exposición lanzará el 17 de octubre en el Instituto Cultural de México e incluye 100 esculturas ubicadas por toda la ciudad. Durante el evento, Sebastián fue nombrado Emisario de las Musas, el reconocimiento más prestigioso que la ciudad de San Antonio entrega a artistas. El alcalde, Ron Nienberg, presentó el honor y habló de las esculturas como símbolo de la amistad entre Estados Unidos y México.
As Master of the Arts and Sciences, you agree to extol San Antonio as a place to live, worship, work, and to play. You shall retain this commission as long as you perform your duties faithfully.
Sebastián dijo que era un honor estar en San Antonio mostrando su trabajo y que muchas de las obras son de diferentes épocas de sus 50 años de carrera.
Es verdaderamente pues un honor para un mexicano por la relación que ha existido desde muchos años atrás, es ancestral prácticamente, la relación histórica de amistad y de conflictos y no conflictos y es toda una historia entre San Antonio y los mexicanos.
El escultor cortó la cinta antes de los presentes para dar la bienvenida a la exposición. Gente cercana a Sebastián habló de su relación con el artista.
We both are Scorpios, and as you notice that I put the sculpture piece here right in front of the gallery because he was born in November 16, 1947, so, and I was born November the 18th, so we have a connection, and just that passion that we have with the arts is incredible to share.
El Departamento de Arte y Cultura de la ciudad presenta la exposición en más de 20 ubicaciones, incluyendo universidades, bibliotecas, museos y el aeropuerto de San Antonio. Las obras en exposición hasta el mayo del 2020. La Universidad Texas A&M San Antonio también es parte de la exposición, con 4 esculturas de Sebastián ubicadas detrás del edificio central, o CAB. Soy Armando Villarreal, Enlace.
Spice is a common fall flavor, but do people really like it? We asked A&M San Antonio students what they really think.
Are you a fan of pumpkin spice?
I love pumpkin spice. I actually just had a pumpkin spice latte earlier.
I am not a fan. It doesn't taste very good.
I do not like pumpkin spice because I'm not basic.
No, I don't really like pumpkin spice. I don't really like pumpkin in general, like the flavor.
Actually, yes, to some degree. I'm more of a fan of pumpkin pie, which shows up in and around this time of year.
I am not a fan of pumpkin spice.
No, I don't like pumpkins or spice. I don't like the coffee drink, no.
Okay. Not too much, no.
Yes, 100%.
A little bit. I'm not really into it as much, but I do enjoy it, yeah.
I am not a fan of pumpkin spice.
No, I hate it.
Yeah, I'm a fan of pumpkin spices.
No.
Not in the way that they sell it commercially. It is not done correctly. There's not enough nutmeg and cinnamon in it.
Here is the latest in movies and entertainment with David Rojas.
¿Qué onda, taquilleros? Bienvenidos una vez más a la tradición de A la Carta. El día de hoy les cuento lo que se estrenará este fin de semana en cines y noticias del entretenimiento. ¡Comenzamos!
¿Alguna vez te has preguntado cuánto tiempo te resta de tu vida? Pues ya existe una película que trata justamente de esta ocasión. Countdown cuenta la historia de una enfermera que baja una aplicación que te dice cuánto tiempo te queda de vida. A esta enfermera le quedan solamente 3 días para vivir. Ahora ella tendrá que buscar una manera de poder salvar su vida antes de que se le acabe el tiempo. Countdown es una película clasificada PG-13 y está en cines a partir del día de hoy.
Yo, ¿estás llamando mi nombre?
Una agente de la policía en New Orleans captura el asesinato de un narcotraficante. Después de enterarse que el asesinato fue un plan de un grupo de policías corruptos, ella se une con la única persona de la comunidad dispuesta en ayudarle. Ahora ella se encuentra huyendo tanto de criminales y como hombres de la ley quienes desesperadamente quieren destruir la grabación. Black and Blue es una película clasificada R y está en cines a partir del día de hoy. Después de haber recibido 93.5 millones de dólares en su semana de estreno, se rumora que Warner planea en producir la secuela de The Joker junto con Joaquín Phoenix. La cinta recibió buenas críticas y hasta el momento lleva mucho más dinero que su presupuesto de producción. Esto le da razón a querer lanzar una continuación a esta película. ¿Les gustaría ver una segunda parte? Y si tú eres fan de la música urbana, el reggaetón y el hip hop, pues esta noticia te va a gustar. En esta semana, el mismo Vin Diesel anunció 2 nuevos integrantes que se unen al elenco de la novena entrega de Fast and the Furious. El martes, Vin Diesel subió una foto en su cuenta de Instagram con el reggaetonero Ozuna anunciando que se une al equipo de Fast and the Furious. Y el miércoles subió un video con nada más y nada menos que con Cardi B y esto fue lo que dijo.
Day 86, here on the set of Fast 9. I know I'm exhausted. We all gave every single thing we could for this movie. Put it all on the table. Put it all out there.
I'm tired. But I can't wait.
¿Cómo ven? ¿Creen que esas estrellas de la música podrán demostrar sus habilidades como actores? Cuéntenme si les gustaría ver a estos dos en la pantalla grande.
Bueno, esto fue todo por hoy. Recuerda que si usted quiere estar al tanto de lo que sucede en el mundo del entretenimiento, me puede seguir a través de mis redes sociales en @2diastaquillando. Hasta la próxima.
From all of us here at Enlace, we thank you for watching and look forward to seeing you again next week.